Welcome to today's meeting. As the invitation says, it will focus on the Gulen Hizmet Movement. Some of you were here then, maybe, in 2009. The event is a follow-up to the event we held here in June 2009, as I said again with Dr. Aslandogan. And before we proceed, I'd like to thank the Rumi Forum for helping us, and Emre Bey for helping us to put the event together. As I said in the invitation to today's event, the Gulen Hizmet Movement, led by Fethullah Gulen, focuses on education and social issues. However, its influence, or even more perhaps its perceived influence, goes well beyond those areas in Turkey, as well as the US and elsewhere around the world. As I said at our last meeting, few people seem to be neutral about the movement. While there's a great deal of praise for the movement in Turkey, the US and elsewhere, for its activities, in particular its schools, there is also some criticism. So we may get into that in the discussion. Dr. Aslandogan is president of the Alliance for Shared Values, a New York-based nonprofit umbrella organization for cultural and interfaith dialogue organizations around the U.S., and is also a board member of the Gulen Institute. It's in Houston, right? Yep. He received his B.A. from Boazici University in 1989, his M.S.C. from Case University in 1995, and his PhD from the University of Illinois in 2001. I'm very much looking forward to his presentation and also to what I hope will be a good discussion afterwards. Dr. Aslandogan, welcome back to CSIS. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Bülent Bey, and to the CSIS for organizing this event and for hosting me. And I am assuming in the audience there are participants who have been to the previous talk, and maybe many of you haven't been. So I'm going to assume that we have people who might be familiar with the movement somewhat, and those who are very familiar have specific questions, as well as those who don't know much about it. Is that a safe assumption? Okay, all right. Because some of the material that I present, maybe you may already know about it, but there may be others who don't. So please excuse that redundancy. The Hizmet movement, that's the preferred terminology used by its participants. In Turkish, the word means service or serving fellow humans or serving your community. Sometimes it's referred to as the Gulen movement by virtue of Mr. Fethullah Gulen, especially by social scientists in the West. But that is not a preferred terminology because it puts too much emphasis on one person. There are other terms used in Turkish and Western context, such as Jamia in Turkish context. And each of these terms, of course, have certain inaccuracies, certain advantages. So I don't think any particular term would be the right term to describe it. So I prefer to use multiple terms. The movement started in Turkey as a community, actually, around someone might call a maverick preacher, a scholar by the name of Gulen. Transformed, and it is still transforming into a social movement, especially during the 90s. So many social scientists see it as a transnational social movement, faith-inspired social movement right now, but some of the aspects of the early decades are still there, those aspects that relate to the community roots. It focuses on education projects, but there are other areas where movement participants have established foundations, sometimes corporations, and associations. These areas include, besides education, healthcare, disaster relief and economic assistance, publications of different forms and formats, and interfaith and intrafaith or intra-society dialogue. There are also a number of professional associations, both in business and in other professions, white collar, blue collar. And these associations serve two purposes. One of them is for the professional development of the members of those associations. And the second purpose is to channel some of their resources toward charitable projects. I will just show some examples of these projects and institutions before talking about them. Then I'll talk about Gulen himself for a little while, and then come back to the movement projects and institutions. This is a snapshot from a school in the city of Bursa. And I'll talk about the education projects in detail later. This particular is a snapshot from a hospital in Şanlıurfa in southeast Turkey that serves both southeast Turkey and also certain parts of Middle East. This is a set of pictures from a village rebuilding project in Darfur that the humanitarian aid and disaster relief organization Kimse Yok Mu, which could be translated as "Isn't there anybody listening?" organized and working on. These are pictures from Gulen's very symbolic pioneering initiatives in interfaith dialogue in the early 90s in Turkey. This is a snapshot from an intellectual meeting in the town of Abant in Turkey. This is the only meeting of its kind which brings together the corners of various segments of the Turkish political and ideological spectrum together. About 100 to 150 intellectuals participate from all corners of political and ideological spectra. What is common among these projects and the volunteers who work on these projects or the officers of the organizations is a concept that I called, that I like to call, the committed core. The committed core concept involves people who are committed to a high cause. They have solidarity around a high cause. As an example, establishing an educational institution, be it a dormitory, be it a tutoring center, be it a school, in a neighborhood which has problems, let's say drug problem. In a community, typically the vast majority of the community would like to get rid of that problem, be it violence or drug or whatever. But often what happens is people with good intentions, they try to do certain things, and when they see that their efforts are going nowhere, they get disheartened, disillusioned, and they simply leave. Or they don't do anything about the solution of that problem. And this continues, and the problem continues. In a community of well-meaning, good intentioned people, we see that those problems continue, because nobody actually goes the final last mile. So in the case of the Hizmet volunteers, and it's not the only example of this concept, by the way, there are many, many other examples around the world. In the case of the Hizmet volunteers, the volunteers see whatever they are doing as something beyond a salary-paying job, as something that gives meaning to their lives. And they have solidarity with their fellow participants around this particular cause. And therefore, they are willing to commit much more to that cause than other well-meaning citizens might. In the case of the drug problem, for instance, in a school environment, if there's a drug problem, a principal or a teacher or a parent or a PTO member is willing to say, drugs will not enter this school over my dead body, if anybody attempts to do that. So such individuals, one and two and three, when they come together in a place, when they make this school free of drugs, then other well-meaning people who were dormant before, they also gather around them. So this committed core actually brings together the good in people, the intentions and the energy in the people, and activates them. And I often use the example of the sugar crystallization experiment, if you've done that in school, or saturation experiment. That is, you pick up a container, put water in it, and then begin heating it. And then at some point, you begin pouring sugar in it. So as you heat the water, its capacity to absorb more sugar increases. So you put more sugar, and then it is saturated at some point. You can no longer put more sugar into it. And then you allow it to cool down. And then at certain point, you drop a little crystal of sugar into that container. And then if you continue to cool down, you see that that little sugar crystal becomes larger and larger and larger. So that little sugar crystal actually serves to coalesce, to bring together the sugar that is already in there, in the water. I think the impact or effect of the Hizmet movement in Turkish and other societies is that because of this committed core, because of these committed individuals, other well-meaning people who want to do good for their society, they coalesce, gather around them to build projects for their society. In this picture, we see examples, snapshots from different projects. For instance, the lady that you see on the left, upper left, She is actually a medical doctor, and together with two or three colleagues, ladies, one psychologist, and one that I don't remember right now, they are running a television show in Turkey that deals with family problems. Three women professionals, they are observant Muslims, and they are dealing with the problems of women and men in families. And they are doing a television show on that. Okay, let's talk about Mr. Fethullah Gulen, who is the core inspirer and motivator for the movement participants. He is a multidimensional person. He is a scholar, he is a thinker, he is a preacher emeritus. He worked for the Turkish government's Directorate of Religious Affairs. That's the only way one can preach in Turkey. So he was a civil servant for a number of years. He is an author, very prolific author. He has, I believe, over 12,000 pages in print right now. His speeches, addresses, short talks are also published on the web. I believe there is over 1,000 hours of audiovisual material that is available, either on the web or in other formats. He is also an educator. That is, he personally teaches. To this day, he teaches a group of graduates of schools of divinity in his residence. And throughout his life, he has been a personal mentor and tutor. He is a progressive scholar and preacher, but he is rooted in tradition. That is, in his interpretation of the Islamic resources, be it the Quran, the commentaries on the Quran, the prophetic tradition, and other resources of the Islamic tradition. He is very progressive, but he is always rooted in tradition. When he brings an interpretation, it is always based on roots in the tradition, based on the this particular hadith, or this, based on the interpretation of this particular scholar. So therefore, he is not cut from the tradition. This is important for his impact, because we see, especially in Western countries, Muslim scholars, thinkers, authors, they may state opinions and write books and speak on topics, and their interpretations are found to be very compatible with Western views. But when they fail to connect with the tradition, they lose impact on Muslim, devout Muslim populations. So in the case of Gulen, his impact is there because he's not cut from the tradition. As examples of his progressive interpretations, he may disagree with that statement, but for instance, there should be no prevention or no restriction on women becoming a president or judge in any society. Democracy as the best form of governance developed by mankind. Or Turkey being a member of the European Union. On issues such as freedom of expression or other basic human rights. On Muslims' approach to arts. He has many progressive interpretations. He is well-versed in both Islamic and Western thought. He often mentions Western thinkers in his speeches. Bergson, Pascal, some of the names, Kant, that come to my mind right now. And he combines intellectual work with field work. That is, he's never actually isolated from the real community service work. From the start, he has been involved. Within the last decade, of course, because of his health condition, he was not able to personally participate in many activities. He continues to speak once or twice a week. He continues to edit some of his works that are about to be published. But most of his life, he was personally involved in actual fieldwork. Some of his stances that were significant when they were expressed, his support for democracy in the 90s, early 90s in democracy, when there was a political Islamist party in Turkey who was about to get to power. And Turkish observant Muslims' attitude toward democracy was mixed. There were arguments that there were some essential incompatibilities there, and Gulen argued that there are no essential incompatibilities, and it is in fact the best, the most compatible form of governance with the Islamic principles that pertain to governance. He supported Turkey's membership in the European Union process, in European Union, and he supported the process. He continues to support that despite the economic troubles that the Union is facing now. Maybe his most prominent and important stance is against violence. And he has been consistent in his stance against violence of all forms, terror of all forms. In his sermons, in his short talks and books, he speaks very clearly, categorically against violence. He rejects terrorism of any kind without regard to the declared cause. For instance, in the case of Palestine or other places when certain individuals identified as Muslim, when they resort to suicide bombings with the rhetoric that they have no other weapon. Gulen categorically rejects that argument. If an end goal is noble, the ways to reach that end goal should also be noble. Having no other means is never a justification for something that is wrong, some action that is wrong. In the case of the 9/11 attacks, he came forward and actually condemned the attackers and the attack with an ad in the Washington Post. And his view on terror was published in a book he helped edit with the views of other Muslim scholars. So there's a book that is published on condemning terror based on Islamic Muslim resource arguments. And recently, he condemned the attacks on the the American ambassador in Libya, and this approach, this view that such actions are can be legitimate. He categorically rejected that approach in an op-ed piece in Financial Times. This is dated September 27. Overall, he promotes democracy, science and arts, spirituality, individual spirituality, and also group spirituality, dialogue, intrafaith, interfaith, intercultural, inter-ideological, inter-political view. Developing a culture of peaceful coexistence is an important item in his discourse. And he stands against politicization of faith. When during the 90s, this issue was very prominent. He declared his view that religion should never be politicized. If that happens, then both politics and religion suffers, and religion suffers more. He is also against shallow and literalist interpretations of tradition that prevent Muslims to become from becoming active participants in pluralist democracies. He promotes deeper, more comprehensive look at the tradition, and also considering the factors that influenced the interpretations of the early ages. The main themes of his advocacy or discourse roughly overlap with the activity areas of the Hizmet movement. So these include education, community service, dialogue, social justice, and virtues, development of virtuous individuals and society. Let me say a couple of words about number four and number five. When we say social justice, there are, of course, multiple dimensions to it. In the Turkish context, one dimension of social justice was to help prevent or eliminate the disenfranchisement of certain segments of Turkish society. In particular, the observant Muslims and also the Kurdish citizens. Because Turkish Republic had an ideology from the beginning, and basically everybody, every citizen was asked to subscribe to that official ideology, which relied upon a nation state, the idea of Turkishness, a particular interpretation of secularism, which is driven from French experience, especially 19th century French experience. An emphasis on elitism and the elites leading the country, seeing religion as essentially negative, preventing people from thinking rationally. So this was the essence of the official ideology. Now, this official ideology was adapted and applied across the government institutions, which resulted in discrimination against many citizens, including observant Muslim citizens. With his efforts, Gulen helped break this monopoly. He encouraged observant Muslim parents to send their kids to schools of law, to schools of military, police, to business. Traditionally, historically, more observant parents were reluctant to send their children to these schools. The argument in their minds was that if I send my child to a law school, the Turkish law at the time included elements from German, Italian, Swiss law. There could be elements that are against my faith. Therefore, if I send my child to the law school, he might have to do things that are contrary to my faith. or if I send my child to the military school, he will become an officer, he won't be able to practice his religion, he will have to drink alcoholic drinks and other things, so I should not send my child to the military school. And similar arguments were developed in the minds of observant citizens. So when you combine this with the discrimination at those government institutions against observant citizens, the end result was the severe underrepresentation of observant Muslims and also other segments of society in these government institutions. So as a contribution to social justice and equal representation, proportional representation, he encouraged sending everybody's children to all these institutions, all these schools, and being there, having their rightful place in these institutions, which is theirs. It's their government, and they have a right and duty to be present in those institutions. So today, in many government institutions, including the military, the judicial system, and other places, there is more proportional representation of the political views, the world views of the Turkish society. And I think Gulen deserves a part of the credit for that. Number five, for the development of virtuous individual and society. From the beginning, Gulen's approach to social transformation was a grassroots, bottom-up approach, which is in contrast with the political Islamist approach. That is more of a top-down approach. That is, Gulen's message was that if you would like to achieve a virtuous society, if you would like to transform your society toward desirable goals from your perspective, then the only way to do it is through cultural and social means. Attempting to employ political mechanisms to impose a particular lifestyle on people's lives is completely unproductive. As a matter of fact, it is counterproductive. So if you would like to achieve a social transformation, go through education and focus on the individual, person by person. Educate them if they are willing to participate in that institution or in that program, and that's the only way to do. I think that presents a sharp contrast with some other movements in the Middle East, and there are experts that talk about this topic, such as Dr. Greg Barton from Australia and Dr. Elizabeth Özdalga from Turkey. All right, now I'd like to go talk a little bit about the institutions and the activities. The educational activities of the movement participants in Turkey have multiple dimensions. If somebody is somehow associated or they are inspired, they are readers of Gulen, they have listened to him or they met with movement participants, they would want to do something about education, no matter where they are and what their position is, career-wise or in their society. And this doing something about education is a very core value, because education is seen as the ultimate solution to all social problems. Yes, government can do and should do certain things. Yes, there should be policies and funding and everything. Yes, yes, yes. But the long-term solution to any social problem has to go through education. Underrepresentation, drug problem, violence problem, social conflict, you name it. All those social issues, they can only be solved for the long term through education. Therefore, if somebody is associated somehow with the Hizmet movement, they would want to do something about education. It could be in the form of supporting a student with a scholarship. It could be choosing education as your career, becoming a teacher. It could be helping support a private school or a tutoring center. It could be helping start a tutoring center. There was an interesting project recently. The Writers and Journalists Foundation, they asked Turkish singers to sing some spiritual religious songs that praise the Prophet and some other religious values. And they collected these songs on a CD, and they actually marketed this CD. And with the revenue from this project, they actually built tutoring centers in Southeast Turkey that help the Kurdish kids there get a better future in and career. Scholarships, actually choosing careers in education, establishing institutions such as dormitories, such as private schools, such as college prep courses, and other forms of educational initiatives. In this particular example, in this picture, we are seeing a group of students in a school in Bursa, and they are in their music class. So these schools are secular curriculum, schools that are open to everybody. and there is no religious education besides whatever government mandates in their official curriculum guidelines. And they are non-sectarian schools. In the smaller picture, you're seeing another little girl who won a medal in a social science Olympiad. Now, this is important because the balance of social sciences with math and science and arts is important for a well-balanced education. In the absence of this balance, it has been seen that the graduates of certain schools which emphasize only physical sciences, they may turn out to be radicals. So in these schools, there is a balance between social sciences and positive sciences and arts. This is an example of, from the Sema Hospital in Istanbul. The attractive feature of these hospitals from the community's point of view is that they are affordable and they bring the latest medical technology to the country. Sometimes when people are cannot afford for certain types of medical care, then there are some mechanisms for funding, helping them actually pay for those treatments. In the smaller smaller picture, you're seeing a volunteer who is probably in some place in Africa. It's a medical service, either screening or free healthcare service in Africa. This is the hospital that I mentioned in the city of Şanlıurfa, and the family that is behind this hospital, not just one family, but the prominent family, is actually a Kurdish family. There are quite a high number of Kurdish participants in the movement. I think, I don't have any statistics, but I think the proportion of Kurdish participants in the movement roughly equal the proportion in the Turkish society, which is about 15% or so, 10 to 20%. This is a snapshot from the efforts of Kimse Yok Mu organization. It is a disaster relief organization which helps the victims of all the major disasters that you can remember from the recent past. And in the smaller picture, you're seeing a volunteer doctor who has done a cataract surgery in probably in Kenya or someplace near Kenya. In the health field, in addition to the hospitals, there are thousands of doctors who are Hizmet movement participants or they are sympathetic. So they participate in these free healthcare service projects. Often the organizer for these projects is the Kimse Yok Mu organization, but there is also a healthcare professionals association that help organize these pro bono volunteer services by doctors and nurses and other healthcare professionals. This is the picture that I mentioned before about rebuilding a village in Darfur. And I have an interesting anecdote with this. I was accompanying a social scientist in interviews in Turkey, and we visited a women's association in Istanbul. I forgot its name right now. But in this association, we met with a lady who apparently was observant, but she was not covered. And when we talked about everybody's profession and what they're doing, she said, "I'm an architect. And I'm drawing the plans for the buildings in this town that Kimse Yok Mu is rebuilding." So a professional lady, observant but not covered, an architect who is doing free architectural work for this project, I thought that picture was very meaningful to represent what Hizmet stands for. In addition to disaster relief, the Kimse Yok Mu organization has many other economic assistance programs. For instance, they have the Sister Family Program, which matches a family in need with a family who is financially more able. And this is a long-term partnership that helps the family in need for the longer term, not just for once. The interfaith dialogue efforts of Mr. Gulen and the movement participants were very symbolically significant in the early 90s. These pictures are from the early 90s, 94, 95 time frame. These are significant not because Turkish people don't have a culture of coexistence. They do. During the Ottoman Empire, Muslims and Christians and Jews and others lived together, of course, with some certain difficulties and with certain restrictions. But nevertheless, by and large, they lived in peace. So there is a culture of actually recognizing the members of other religions and respecting their religious practice. But during the First World War, things changed. Especially during the Turkish War of Independence, things changed. A small portion of the Greek community in Turkey, Greek Christian Orthodox community in Turkey, sided with the Greeks and their supporter British against the Turkish War of Independence. And also a small portion of the Armenian community sided with the Russians and the British against, again, the Turkish community. Therefore, these situations left a scar in the collective mind of the Turkish population. So although they have a history of living together and respecting other religions, these events, the terrible events during the last periods of Ottoman Empire and the beginning of Turkish Republic, these left a big scar in the minds of the Turkish people. The question was, is the loyalty of these citizens, non-Muslim citizens, is their loyalty to Turkish state, or is their loyalty to their fellow brethren in religion or ethnicity? So these scars continued into the 80s and 90s. So with his efforts, Gulen actually helped close a page, and it is a work in progress, obviously. But he helped close a page in history and open a new page. Okay, in the beginning of our country, maybe certain members of religious minorities did certain things that we don't approve and that were against their country. But that's history. And you cannot blame the members of all that community for the actions of a few. Therefore, let's close that page and open a new page. We are in a new world. We are in a globalizing world. We have to learn to treat each other in ways that we have not done before. The environments that we are living in, that the countries that we are living in, this is a total new situation. In history, we did not have liberal democratic countries. We did not have governments who did not subscribe to a particular religion. They did not require their citizens to subscribe to a religion. They did not restrict, not restricting the religious practice. This situation did not happen in history. So we are facing a new situation. We should position ourselves and our treatment of others according to this new situation. So this was the main message. And he also promoted the bringing out the best in religion. When some people use religion to divide, let's use religion, the elements of the religious discourse and practice to unite. That was the main message of these meetings. Now, because of the scars that I mentioned, when Gulen did these moves, it was controversial, especially among the more radical circles, be it religious or ultra-nationalist circles. There were CDs blaming Gulen that were distributed. Hundreds of thousands of CDs were distributed to the homes, charging Gulen to be a secret Catholic, a secret Jew, or secret something that is working for foreign governments or for CIA. To this day, you can go to the web and pick up pictures that shows the Gulen movement underneath the super NATO or CIA or Mossad or something. To this day, you can find those claims. So when Gulen did these moves, it was courageous. And it was deeply appreciated by the religious minority leaders. You might have heard recently, the Turkish government decided to return some of the real estate that was confiscated from religious minorities earlier, after the military coup of 1971. So the Turkish government decided to return those properties to religious minorities, which, of course, they were very happy with this decision. But the Greek Orthodox leader, Mr. Bartolomeos, said that these actions of the government, the environment, the atmosphere for these actions to take place were prepared by Gulen's efforts. He is on the record for saying this. As a consequence of his contribution to interfaith dialogue in Turkey and elsewhere, Mr. Gulen received a personal audience with the late Pope John Paul II. The Abant meeting in Turkey brings together intellectuals from all corners of the political and ideological spectrum. It's the only meeting of its kind with over 100 participants. It takes place in different places every year, sometimes multiple times every year. So this is a contribution to intra-faith or societal dialogue, if you will. And all these efforts, especially dialogue and tolerance-related efforts, have been recognized at the highest level of Turkish government and also by world leaders. And you see the pictures of some of the former Turkish ministers, prime ministers, presidents, and also some notable world leaders who congratulated and praised the efforts of Mr. Gulen and the Hizmet movement in these fields.
Can you go back to the last picture? Was that Mr. Erdogan at the bottom, in the middle picture?
Yes.
Was he prime minister then?
I believe he was the mayor at that time. This picture is from a group of students, and again in southeast Turkey. This is the school building. This is an example from a college prep course, again in Southeast Turkey, and they are very proud with the students that they placed in schools of medicine, especially, which is the number one thing among the families in Turkey. As a matter of fact, I'm seeing now all of those pictures are from schools of medicine. But on the right-hand side, you can also see that they placed students in schools of law, schools of pharmacy, schools of education in engineering, in veterinarian, and sciences. So these schools and the tutoring centers do a great service to the citizens, to the children in that region, historically underserved. A group of students with Dr. Martha Ann Kirk from from a university in Texas. She did a couple of studies in Southeast Turkey and Northern Iraq, studying the Hizmet-related institutions and their services there. This picture is also very important. Again, in Southeast Turkey, some observant parents are reluctant to send their daughters besides whatever is required by the government to the schools. They are worried about moral issues, social issues that pertain to their daughters. So in the case of the Hizmet Movement related institutions, be it a school or tutoring center, the movement's values give them confidence that when they send their children, then their daughters, to these institutions, then certain social values are preserved and observed and represented, so they can comfortably. So actually, the movement helps educate the girls in Southeast Turkey and other places where there are observant parents. For those who are interested in more detailed studies of the movement, there is a work by Dr. Helen Roziba, who is a sociologist. There is a more intellectual kind of publication by Dr. Jill Carroll on comparing Gulen's views with the prominent Western thinkers. There are 9 pages in the book of Mr. Graham Fuller named The New Turkish Republic. He devoted 9 pages to the movement, which I find to be very objective. He discusses both the movement values, projects, and also critics. I think it's very objective, balanced treatment of the movement. If you just have little time to devote to this topic, then those 9 pages, I think, your first point of start. Dr. Mohamed Çetin has a book based on his dissertation. There are multiple books, edited books, based on conferences that involve many Western social scientists. One of them is edited by Dr. Hakan Yavuz and Dr. Esposito, another one by Dr. İhsan Yılmaz and Dr. Esposito, one by myself and Dr. Robert Hunt. So you can find those on Amazon.com. So that's the end of my presentation, and I would be happy if I could help respond to some of your questions.
Thank you very much. Very interesting and very full presentation, just like the last time. You didn't say it explicitly. I want to set up the discussion by focusing on one part of your presentation, which relates to the politicization of faith. You said that Fethullah Gulen was against that. Now, just to set up the discussion here, we have a situation in Turkey in which the, as you said, the exclusion of the observant, I'm quoting from you, of the observant Muslims from Turkish politics is no longer the case. They're with Fethullah Gulen's encouragement, they've been brought into the equation. We have a party that is rooted in the political Islamist movement, stretching all the way back to the early 70s through a number of parties, which has the support of almost 50% of the Turkish electorate, as we know from the last election. Now, the Gulen movement, you didn't say it explicitly this time, you confirmed it implicitly, is not involved in politics. But everything somehow becomes political in every society, including in Turkey. What is the position of the Gulen Hizmet movement on the growing religiosity of politics? Or, if I can put it in another way, there's a healthy discussion of this in Turkey. How much more religious will Turkey get under a party that may be blurring the line between religious devotion and politics? Would you like to address that?
Let me first begin by saying, putting my disclaimer that the views that I express are my personal views. They are not the views of my organization or the movement in general, which I think is impossible to express the views in by one person. So these are my personal views. Now, the relationship of the movement with the political parties. The movement has always been based on values. As a matter of fact, the concept of sharing values, despite coming from different backgrounds, holds a special place in Gulen's discourse. There was a group of social scientists who visited him some years ago. I think one of them was Dr. Louis Canturi from University of Maryland, if I remember correctly. But I heard this incidents from two persons who were present there in this meeting. So Dr. Canturi and others who are present kept referring to the movement as Gulen movement. And at some point, Mr. Gulen stopped them. He said that, I don't like this term to be used to refer to the movement. It puts too much emphasis on one person who is just one participant. If you like to refer to the movement, I would encourage you to use the movement of humans who are gathered around high human values. Of course, that's too long. Nobody actually used that. But I think it's interesting to observe that when he began talking about referring to the movement, this is the first thing that he says, that this is a movement about values. And the basic assumption or premise is that these values are values that we can agree to some degree so that we can work together. We don't have to agree 100% on how we define these values. Even members of the same faith or same culture don't agree 100%. But we can reach an agreement that is good enough that allows us to work together. Okay. The example of, for instance, a school that completely keeps out the drugs and violence and bullying, be it in Turkey, be it in Romania, be it in the Philippines. This is a value, protecting our children, our youth, from self-destructing habits, is a value that we can work around. I am an observant Turkish Muslim, and my partner could be a Buddhist. The other partner could be an agnostic. Another partner could be a Christian or Jew or Hindu. Doesn't matter. And we come from the same value from different backgrounds. The Buddhist has a certain concept of karma or whatever that brings him to this value. And I come from the Muslim perspective. It doesn't matter. We want to protect our youth from self-destructing habits. We want those destructive things to reach our youth. We agree on this. We can work together around this. So the movement from the start has been a values-based movement. Now, sociologically, of course, the vast majority of the participants come from Turkish Muslim or Anatolian Muslim, including Kurdish and other ethnicity Muslims. But it has always been an open movement. And when you look at the discourse of Gulen and the institutions and the activities of the movement, you see what those values are. Democracy is certainly one of them. Respecting diversity and pluralism, giving a place for people of different orientations to live in a society, that's one of them. Respecting the parents, with the exception of the abuse cases, is a value. You can put these values together based on Gulen's discourse and also based on the values cherished by these institutions or their activities. So the relationship of the movement with the political parties throughout the existence, the evolution of the movement in Turkey, has been based on values. These are our values. These are the ones that the things that we cherish in our work, in our discourse. And if a political party is supportive of those values, then it is expected sociologically that movement participants would lean toward that party as long as that party supports those values. So in the Turkish experience, when Özal was alive, it would be safe to say that a good majority of the participants might have voted for his party as long as he supported Turkey's moving toward European Union, Turkey's moving toward democratization, empowering civil society, empowering market economy. And then Özal died and other parties came to the fore. And we know that during Ecevit's time, who is actually leader of a left party, Ecevit was also pro-European Union, pro-democratization. He was also against the militarization of Turkish politics. So it's safe to say during Ecevit's time, many movement participants actually favored his party. So the movement's relationship with the parties is based on the values. Just as people from different backgrounds coalesce around different values, the support for a political party or the lack of the support is based on what that party cherishes in their practice, in their rhetoric, and whether their values, their practice intersects with the values of the movement.
Just to follow up, and then I'll open the floor up to questions. Now, given that you're against the politicization of faith, and taking your disclaimer that you don't speak for the movement per se, understandably, are you concerned about what may be the politicization of faith in Turkey? And to add one more aspect to our discussion, the EU process seems to have dropped off the agenda. You've stressed the importance of the goal of EU membership for Fethullah Gulen and members of the movement. Does that concern you as an individual or as a member of the movement?
Yeah. Let me start with the second one because that's a shorter answer. Turkish people in general had mixed opinions about the European Union from the early stages, but as the steps were taken to move Turkey toward the European Union, and as Turkish economy grew, and it actually became a real possibility for Turkey to join European Union, then people reconsidered their position on the European Union. It became obvious, especially during the 80s and the 90s, it became obvious that European Union process could be a major motivator and driving force for democracy in Turkey. Many of the taboos that could not be broken before were broken thanks to the European Union accession process. For instance, giving the Kurdish citizens the right to broadcast in their language. There were times in Turkey, if you proposed this, you could be jailed, beaten, tortured, and you could be executed even. But it became a reality thanks to the European Union accession process. So during the 90s, I think especially, it became very obvious that the European Union process plays a big role in moving Turkey toward democratization. Mr. Gulen has always approached this matter from a point of confidence that when people were worried about if we join the Union, are we going to lose our Islamic values or practice? Are we going to become more like Europeans in their culture and so on and so forth? He was always confident that if you believe in your tradition, in the strength of your tradition, you have nothing to fear. From these interactions, good will come, not bad. So did this position, the support for democratization, the support for Turkey is becoming eventual a member, this position did not change. And the steps taken toward membership, the developments during the early 2000s were much swifter and decisive compared to the last few years. So I think, as far as I can observe in the movement-related publications, there is a bit of disillusionment in the lack of the speed, in the lack of the motive to move further in joining the European Union. So this position, as far as I know, has not changed. Your first part?
About the, I was rephrasing my first question again. I hope you can answer it somewhere. But there is, we're talking about an Islamic-based party, a party with its roots in the Islamist movement, more correctly. And there is, some of his critics say that there is a politicization of faith. And you specifically said that that was something that Fethullah Gulen opposed. Do you have a view on that?
Okay. I think when we look at the issue of politicization of faith, it was more clear, more crystal in the case of the welfare party or its various versions during the 90s. There was a rhetoric that we represent devout Muslims in this country, and if you're a devout observant Muslim, you ought to vote for us. And we're going to pass laws to make sure that we live in a more virtuous society. That kind of approach was very clear in the rhetoric of the welfare party, and Gulen was clearly against it. He rejected this approach completely. First of all, nobody, no party can claim to represent Muslim, devout Muslims in a country. And the approach of top-down through legal system or through government apparatus to impose a lifestyle is counterproductive. It's against essential Muslim Islamic principles of freedom of choice. So in that case, it was clear. Now, in the case of the last decade, as far as I know, maybe if we can be more specific about the allegations, we can talk more clearly about them. But as far as I know, there is no attempt to pass a law that is based on the Islamic principles at the parliament. I only know of two cases. One of them is which can be seen as a humanitarian issue, to allow for the women, for the girls to dress with their headscarf in education institutions. That was passed but returned by the Constitutional Court. And the other one was, I think there was an attempt to criminalize adultery. So besides these two, I don't know of any attempt to actually pass an Islamically based law in the parliament. So when you say, you know, Islamization of politics within the last decade, I think I'll need to more concrete examples of efforts.
Well, maybe I'll get back to it, but the floor is open so that other people can pick it up. Go ahead. Can you hit the mic?
My name is Barry Jacobs, and I've been following Turkey, as Bulent knows, for at least carefully for the last 16 years. But I don't speak Turkish, and I've always had a little problem trying to understand Hizmet and its effect with a government in Turkey since, what, trying to think, 2003, that clearly expresses strong affiliation for Islamic values. How come Gulen Bey, is that how I would say it, has never returned to Turkey even for a visit? And the second question is, which is related to the first, I think Pennsylvania is a lovely place, but it just seems to me, again, as an outsider, slightly strange that rather than settle when he left Turkey in some country that was both closer and perhaps more culturally affiliated, what is he doing in the Pennsylvania countryside? Besides, I suppose, going to Penn State football games, but that's it.
All right. Well, the reason for Mr. Gulen's not returning to Turkey, this is a question that that is being asked by many people. According to his statement, he said that he is worried that his return to Turkey might be taken advantage of by some people who would like to move Turkey backward from democratizing steps. So interpreting this statement, my view is that because he is so influential in Turkey, his return to Turkey will be seen as an opportunity to achieve a political goal by whoever they are. And, you know, many candidates can be thought of right now. So Mr. Gulen thinks that his return can be turned into a bir kupla event that would ultimately damage the democratization process in Turkey. Despite the fact that he definitely wants to return, and he actually keeps little pieces of soil from various parts of Turkey in his room, he says, I don't see the environment right now ready. My worries are not quelled at the moment. So there is no legal reason for him not to return. He can return. And the government, on a number of occasions, invited him. Government officials invited him. Others invited him on a number of occasions. He can return anytime. But I think he is waiting for the consolidation of democracy in Turkey, in which people can speak their mind very, very openly, freely. And something that the minister says, or some prominent civic leader says, is not immediately turn into a big conflict or a sensational item in the news.
Go ahead.
You had one more?
Well, the other part was it just, again, I
I'm sorry.
I can understand him, I don't, but I can understand him why he hasn't, for the, especially under the former governments before Erdogan power, but it just seems to me a very kind of a bizarre place. There are plenty of places in Europe that also practice democracy that have larger Muslim populations percentage-wise than the United States. I'm sure it's a lovely place. People have been there. It's a beautiful estate, but it just seems to me a little bit strange. I can't quite understand why this man who is a very concerted Islamic theoretician, et cetera, why he would be comfortable or satisfied sitting in the middle of eastern Pennsylvania.
Okay, I'm not sure if this. I'm not sure if this question was asked, that specifically. But I know that he commented on, some of the reasons for him being here. Well, the reason for his coming here is very clear. That is for medical treatment, in both Cleveland Clinic and also Mayo Clinic, and I believe in a hospital nearby his residence. He went through multiple treatments, operations. He has a couple of stents, I think, in his heart valves. Heart vessels. So the initial reason for him to come here was to get treatment. But after he came here, because of the hot political climate in Turkey, his doctors recommended that he not return, because stress is very harmful to his health. It is already fragile. So he, in those times, he remained here to stay away from the stress. But if you want to ask more generally for preferring to stay here, he mentioned that he appreciates the tradition of democracy in America a lot. When he talks about the superpowers or the big powers of the world, he on a number of occasions mentioned that the United States is the most democratic of those big powers in the world. And if you can talk about leadership of some kind in the world, because of its democratic tradition, the United States deserved that position more than others.
Of course.
He also mentioned on a couple of cases the high standards of U.S. medical institutions, which was in contrast with the Turkish hospitals of that time, in which the doctors treated patients like servants or, I don't want to say slaves, but basically people who ought to obey their commands and do exactly as they say. And they had little respect. They were speaking from a position of, higher authority. So that was in contrast. And also the environments were not very attractive. So he praised the U.S. medical institutions on a number of cases, both for the doctors' respect for the patient's rights, patient's sensitivities, and also for the environmental design.
Of course, they interpreted or looked at the other way, given the fact that he respects the tradition of democracy in the U.S. It leads people to interpret his reluctance to return as perhaps a lack of confidence in the Turkish democratic system, even after, as Barry says, 10 years of what one would assume to be a friendly government. I won't expect you to comment on that, but we'll go to the next question. Go ahead.
Yours, please. Can you hit the mic? Hi, I'm Jim Loeb from Interpress Service, and I was very grateful that Emery has taken me to on one of the trips to Turkey. I have three questions. I don't think that's probably fair, but I'll state them very briefly, and you can decide which ones you want to answer. And the first is, to what extent is the movement, is the relationship between business interests in Anatolia and the movement? I mean, clearly, there seems to be some dialectic between the two, both with respect to where you cultivate your core kind of volunteers and funders, but also in terms of when it goes out into countries like Senegal, there are Turkish businesses, and then that follows movement schools. That's my first quick question. Second is the Kurdish issue. Could you elucidate that? It's becoming increasingly acute with the Assyrian situation and the increasing possibility of a transnational Kurdish movement. Does the movement, or secession, or independence, or whatever, Does the movement, is it concerned about that, and how does it relate to the situation in Syria? And third, finally, one of the criticisms I've heard a lot is the notion that the movement, insofar as it has a central direction, has essentially infiltrated the police and the prosecutor's offices, and we see in the Sledgehammer and in the other Ergonicon case, either an attempt to protect the democratic advances against a possible revanchist military, or we see a more aggressive approach to punishing those who are laicists and those who supported the previous secular regimes. Again, you can comment on all three. I'm sorry for asking so many
three questions. Big questions. I don't know how long it's going to take in answering them.
How many hours did we have?
I'm sorry.
Let me make an attempt. I think we have about 23 minutes more.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, the business interest in Anatolia. In Turkey, we often talk about different generations of businesses. The first generation of very big businesses in Turkey, they were nurtured by the early governments, and they tended to be more politically, ideologically aligned with the official ideology. Especially with Menderes and then Özal, came a second generation of businesses hailing more from Anatolia, that is the Asian part of Turkey, the bigger part of Turkey. And these tend to be more personally observant Muslim, but also at home and comfortable in free market economies, in democracies, in global trade. They are more competitive. They have been more competitive. The first generation of businesses, after dragging their feet for a long time, they also became very competitive. They also deserve praise for that. But the second generation business from Anatolia, they have always been in a competitive environment. They never benefited from the government largesse. And among this second class generation of businesses, does the movement find greater support? As you know, Özal's policies and some of the other governments empowered these businesses, you know, they got bigger, and as they got bigger, their contribution to the movement projects got bigger. When the movement began to become transnational in the 90s, some of these businessmen actually went to those other countries, Central Asia or other countries, and they set up businesses there. And this was working to support those educational institutions, our charitable works in those countries, and also for these businesses themselves, it turned out to be very beneficial. They were shielded from some of the fluctuations in Turkish economy better. So it was an unintended consequence which actually helped them. In some cases, some educators being in that country earlier helped maybe these businesses set up shop faster. That was also an unintended consequence of the movement's involvement there. I'm not sure if that answers your question to some degree. Okay. For the Kurdish issue, now, on the Kurdish issue, actually, Mr. Gulen has stated his view on a number of occasions. And he proposed a multifaceted, multidimensional approach. Because the problem itself is multidimensional, the approach should be multidimensional. The problem obviously has a national security dimension. There is a terror dimension. But at the root of the terror issue lie social issues, particularly the imposition of a state, official state ideology on the Kurdish population, that is denying their Kurdish identity, denying their rights to speak their language or teach in that language. This was at the root of the Kurdish problem. Now, we know that the vast majority of the Kurdish citizens did not choose to react to this policy violently, but there were these organizations such as PKK established, and they recruited from among Kurdish population. And the reason they could recruit, in part, was of the social root of the problem. So unless the social root of the problem is taken care of, there is no way the terror aspect is taken care of. That doesn't mean the two problems are the same. They are different problems. They are related problems. So both aspects need to be addressed. Now, for the social and political aspect of the problem, Gulen's approach was multifaceted. One of them is, as always, we have to work through education, educating Turkish kids about the issues that face the Kurdish part of the society, and educating Kurdish kids about citizenship, democratic ways, political means, and also the impact of violence and terrorism. So through education, things should be done. Another facet was the empowerment of the civil society organizations and leaders and advocates. Because these civil society players and actors have been silenced by the PKK terrorist organization. They have been intimidated. And the civil society often sides on the side of the peace. Therefore, the empowerment of the civil society leadership, opinion leaders, people who are respected by their fellow Kurdish citizens, their empowerment was another aspect of this solution. Another aspect was, or facet was, the economic development of the region. Again, poverty is a driving force for recruitment for violent activities. Or it makes it easier as a recruitment ground. And also an emphasis on the aspects that unite, that bring together Kurdish and Turkish populations, as opposed to de-emphasizing them. For instance, the vast majority of 80%, it changes, but depending on the study, but about 80, 85% or 90% of Turkish population are technically, literally, Sunni Muslims. And for the Kurdish population, their majority is also Sunni Muslims. So this is a common point. Can we take advantage of this point without politicizing religion? That was one point of Gulen. And also through education, just as we educate on mutual respect and tolerance and empathy, also through education, giving hope to the youth. Because hopelessness, desperation, is one of the main driving factors for terrorist activities. When the youth doesn't see any hope, no light in the end of the tunnel, then it's a lot easier to recruit them. That is why some of the educational institutions in Southeast were actually sabotaged by the PKK organization. Ultimately, it came to the parents, Kurdish parents, to say no to the PKK. These schools and tutoring centers are really helping our children. You're not touching them. This was their response. So the approach to the Kurdish issue is to deal with the causes, root causes, social and political causes of the problem that end up making it easier to recruit for terrorism. And for the terrorist activities, of course, the government will use its means to deal with the terrorists. The third question was... The term infiltration have been used many times, countless times, by Turkish media in the Turkish context. The very term actually implies something. Okay, when you say people who like a preacher, who read his words, who are sympathetic to him, they are infiltrating this institution. You know, this mentality, this actually talks about a mentality that this institution belongs to a certain group of the population. It is there, so anybody who doesn't think like them, if they enter that institution, they are infiltrating it. We're talking about Turkish citizens. It is their very right to be in every institution of their government. So who is infiltrating where? I think the term actually, when you talk about infiltration, it is speaking about, I'm not of course addressing you, but you know, many people use this term in Turkish media. It is talking about a certain mentality of monopolizing government institutions, not allowing anybody who doesn't subscribe to this ideology to be in there. So when that actually happens, it is seen as infiltration. Now in reality, sociologically, in government institutions today, there are many people who are sympathetic to Gulen's views. This is because of his advocacy, decades of advocacy in Turkey, open, clear, public advocacy. When you look at any particular institution, there would be some number of people who would be sympathetic. There is no question about it. How do these people behave in situations of decision? If they are truly influenced by Gulen's discourse, it is out there, it is public. You can look at that discourse. And there are sometimes public statements on issues. So if they are truly influenced, you can tell how would they behave based on this discourse and the field work that is out there. So if we talk about the particular legal cases, investigations and legal cases, again, I have to come back to the values. Democratization is important. It's a core value. If people have committed crimes in the past, it is the duty of the judiciary to do something about it. As a citizen, every citizen can support a value and can support their government or judicial system to do whatever is necessary within the law without restricting human rights and freedoms to take the necessary steps to deal with those potential alleged crimes and also to prevent through other means, again, legal means, to prevent such atrocities from taking place again. I think to name this as a revenge, again, would reflect a particular mentality. It would not reflect the objective reality. It is basically talking about people's intentions. Okay, you're doing this because you want to take revenge. That is your opinion of my intention.
You know, the Congress is following up here because the Prime Minister himself went on TV and after the attempt by prosecutors to question his chief of intelligence, specifically said that there could not be a state within a state. It was quite clear to everybody listening to him what he had in mind. Now, this is a common subject of discussion inside Turkey, in Turkey. I mean, following up from his question, not just with respect to those who may have been involved in coup plots in 2003, but the way in which prosecutors, allegedly part of the movement, as you said, they may have certain views. You put it in a very articulate fashion, but that they don't necessarily have to be part of that movement. Even if they reject it subjectively, there is an objective accusation directed at the movement that, particularly through the special courts, including by the Prime Minister himself, in so many words, again, going back to the earlier point, you're not involved in politics, but inevitably, given the strength of the movement inside Turkey, that has brought you into the discussion. That must make you uncomfortable with the accusations and the questions that have been addressed to you and to Fethullah Gulen himself by people who are not necessarily hostile to the movement.
Yes. These accusations and allegations, come from usually attributing certain motives to people. If there are objective evidence, if there are investigations or court cases that actually demonstrate that people act in certain ways because of their influence or because of something that they hear or they are told, then I would be happy to talk about them. But the allegations don't go beyond the level of hearsay. And in the past, we have actually seen examples of hearsay that turned out to be completely opposite. In the previous discussion here, there was a question about preferential hiring for movement participants by the governments at that time. So these are all based on hearsay, sometimes the reality completely contrary to the hearsay.
Carol.
Thank you. I also have a few questions, if you don't mind. With regard to your presentation, there was a lot of emphasis upon the movement's philanthropic efforts in the Southeast. And in the Kurdish media, there does seem to be a suspicion of the movement's intentions. And I was wondering if you could tell me if and to what extent the movement people in the Southeast interact with the BDP or the KCK or any of the acknowledged representatives of the Kurdish community, and what you might do to assuage their concerns that the movement may have a Turkish nationalist intention with regard to the Kurdish area. The second question has to do with, I'm not quite sure if I would put it under the rubric of interfaith dialogue, but maybe why not. You show the various other religions in Turkey with which Mr. Gulen has had relations and the movement has relations. I was wondering if you could tell me if the movement has an opinion or an interrelationship with the Alevis, who are a large minority in Turkey. And finally, this question of suspicion, it doesn't seem to go away. And I thought there was a very interesting episode on the United States program 60 Minutes a while back. And there does seem to be a suspicion of some kind of ultimate goal of some kind, connection with the movement, the state within the state, or the takeover of the state, or something which is not necessarily benevolent, but maybe nefarious in some extent. I was wondering if you could address those suspicions in any way, or the way the 60 Minutes episode seems to end. Thank you. Sorry for the too many questions.
I guess it's becoming a tradition to ask three questions. Okay.
Important questions all.
All right. Now, of course, these are complex questions and issues, so I will say a few things that may not be very cohesive. Please excuse that. Now, I know that in certain elements of Kurdish media, or media in Kurdish language, there are suspicions. To what degree that actually represents the Kurdish population is a question, I think.
Can I interrupt you for 1 second?
Yeah.
Have there not been assassinations of members of the movement by the PKK in the Southeast?
Yeah, I know one at least. There might be others. To what degree the media in Kurdish language actually represent the views of the Kurdish population is a question. When we actually look at the institutions and the activities in those heavily Kurdish areas in Southeast, We see that the Kurdish people embrace the movement because they see that the educational institutions bring hope. They help prevent recruitment by PKK. And people are sincere there. They sometimes actually put their lives to do that service there. Because PKK is serious. I mean, they bomb places, they shoot people. It is serious. So if you are, let's say, ethnically Turkish and you're serving in that region, it is sometimes at, you know, at the cost of your life that you're accepting to serve in that region. So people, I think Kurdish people realize that. These participants, they mean to really help our children. So they embrace it. I don't know of any public reaction to the activities in the region. Now, when it comes to the more political issues, yes, there are voices criticizing the movement for the alleged links with the judiciary and with the handling of the KCK case. Again, to what degree that represents the Kurdish opinion overall, I'm not sure about that. And I'm not the right person to actually talk about it. We have other experts here who know much more about it. We can give them some little bit of time to talk about it. Now, the Turkish nationalist allegation, it is true that Gulen on a number of occasions said that I love my national or heritage, meaning the Turkish heritage. I love my heritage. But on each of those occasions, he always said, this is not, I don't mean this in any discriminative way, in any exclusive way. And on a number of occasions, he also mentioned that when he talks about the Turkish heritage or history, what he means is the Anatolian cultures, Anatolian people that includes the Kurds and the Laz and the Boshnaks and the others. So it is a term that is used often to refer to these people that is found in the discourse sometimes. Now, when you actually look at the activities, the institutions, whether in their practice there is a nationalistic tendency, I don't think there is any objective evidence for that. And you can, I think, maybe an indirect evidence for that is the fact that both nationalists and ultra-nationalists and neo-nationalists, they are not necessarily, by and large, sympathetic to the movement. You know, Turkish ultra-nationalist movement is actually not very sympathetic, by and large, not everybody. Okay. The issue of Alevis. On the issue of the Alevi population, which is very significant, sizable, there were a number of proposals by Mr. Gulen and some of the initiatives by the Journalists and Writers Foundation. For instance, there was a proposal, I don't know at what time, it was proposed to set up the places of worship for places where there is an Alevi population who requests or who needs it. As far as the recognition of Alevi identity and also for not imposing a particular teaching on the Alevi population, I think the movement is on the same page with those with the Alevis on those issues. Now, Gulen himself, of course, comes from the Sunni tradition, so his interpretations are based on the Sunni tradition. But in terms of interacting and living together in harmony with the Alevi population, I think they have moved and acted on a number of occasions to make it possible. They have been in interaction. The Journalists Foundation have been in interaction with some Alevi groups and associations to help eliminate the suspicions between Sunnis and Alevis, to help eliminate the stereotypes. For instance, there was a case when there were some allegations made about Alevi practices. Mr. Gulen actually came out and made a statement that these are false allegations and they are used to polarize the population. They are completely untrue. And he defended the Alevi population against these accusations. So when you look at the individual things that he said or when the individual initiatives of the Journalists and Writers Foundation, there's not much you can criticize, but there is a lot to praise. Again, if there is criticism, it is coming from the potentials, attributed intentions.
I think we may have time for two more questions. Go ahead. Yes.
I come from Pakistan and thanks Emreach for inviting me over for this event. I wanted to ask one into three questions. Let me make a good ice cream.
Everybody gets the right for three.
What is the influence of Gulen movement on the development of business from moving away from Tusiyad and over to Musiyad, more like a conservative, socially conservative and politically more democratic, from Tusiyad to Musiyad and Tuzgan? What's the influence of this movement on Ahmed Davutoglu's zero conflict and moving over to the Turkish relationships with Greece, Armenia, and Russia. And third, I would like to ask, I would like to state over here that the Gulen Movement schools are doing a marvelous job in Pakistan. There are more than 17 schools in Pakistan studying 6,000 Pakistani students over there. And in Pakistan's last floods, where 10% of Pakistani population was affected, one of the two, three organizations which did a tremendous work, Kim Seok and IHH, were there. Thank you.
That's the question, and I don't know if that Dr. Aslandogan will want to touch on the foreign policy aspect of it, but maybe you want to touch either on the first one and perhaps the second one.
Foreign policy is really not my area, so respectfully, I will not touch upon that. But in terms of the businesses, the associations in Turkey, TÜSİAD, MÜSİAD, and there's also TUSKON, the vast majority of the businesses that support the movement projects tend to be in TUSKON Confederation. There are others who are in the MÜSİAD Alliance, and there are some in the TÜSİAD Alliance. I am not aware of any encouragement to actually move from one association to the other. I think the businessmen actually make their choices of whatever association they find closer to themselves as far as their services, their, you know, what does their fellowship mean. And also sometimes, you know, there are implicit, non-explicit guidelines on who are, you know, the nature of the association. For instance, TÜSİAD tends to be more bigger businesses. I'm not aware of any encouragement to change associations or form associations of any kind, but I just know that TUSKON actually holds the vast majority of the supporters from the business field.
Okay. Anybody else? Anybody, please.
What are the contributions of the movement to relations between U.S. and Turkey?
Actually, before you answer the question in 30 seconds, you know, at some stage, the movement decided to expand beyond Turkey into the outside world. And, you know, you're very much part of the movement in the U.S. And the U.S. is perhaps as important what you're doing here as Turkey. So to underline the point that Ali Aslan made, it is something that that I wondered about. How are you contributing to this relationship simply by the virtue of the fact that you are engaged in such significant activities on both sides?
Okay, let me begin with the activities in America that I believe are contributing to U.S.-Turkish relationships. In the United States, there are a number of cultural organizations and business organizations that attract the movement participants. One type of organization is about interfaith and intercultural dialogue. Another type of organization, sometimes these two might be united, is about promoting Turkish-American relationships, Turkish-American culture, helping with the integration of Turkish immigrants to America. Another type of organization is business associations, Turkish-American businesses. All of these organizations do activities that in one way or another help improve the Turkish-American friendship. For instance, through the trips that many of these organizations organize, American participants actually get to see the Turkish environment and learn more about Turkish culture. And then in exchange, many Turkish businessmen and also the official states, state officials and civic leaders are, they come visit America. They participate in the festivals and other events that are taking place here, conventions that are taking place. So they get a chance to actually come and meet with American officials or state representatives. So there is a high level of interaction going on through these trips. And I find them very significant because many of these people, they are very busy. It's very hard to find a couple of hours in their schedules. But on a trip, they get a chance to actually experience the culture firsthand in its original place. And then they come back with a great impact. I have personally heard a number of them say that it was a life-changing trip for them. And the same thing happens for Turkish visitors to America. When they come here and visit with be it religious or civic leaders or government leaders, they say it changed their opinion of America greatly. So at the personal, individual level, there is this activity. And also just for the, you know, for the fact that the movement is so active here, and it is encouraging, helping Turkish immigrants or second-generation immigrants to become contributing active citizens. That by itself, on the overall, as a general picture, is helping develop this friendship. When you look at the discourse, in Gulen's discourse, for instance, some of the points always come to the fore. America's democratic tradition, America's setting an example with its democracy, despite its flaws, still far ahead of many other democracies in the world. So this praise for American democratic tradition, I think, is helping improve the perception and therefore the friendship between the two countries. And there are probably other activities that I'm forgetting right now. In Turkey, I am also aware of certain activities of Journalist Foundation that cater to either diplomats or journalists, and also involve Turkish intellectuals and Turkish journalists and Turkish civic leaders that help improve the friendship and advance the friendship. So if I'm forgetting something, feel free to remind me.
Okay, final question. I promise, just one question.
If I may, so one thing I forget is that the business associations are actually working on improving business ties. So by arranging visits for American businesses to Turkey and vice versa, they are helping find common points of interest and potentials for trade. And as you know, political scientists say, trade on equal terms, when the two parties are participating without any domination, trade is the best means of developing friendship. So I think that's very significant.
Does Gulen have any position on the nature of social interaction between men and women, simple things like shaking hands?
Gulen spoke on a number of occasions on the role and the status of women in the society. In terms of the particular interaction between men and women, there are certain elements or guidelines that come from the tradition that can be traced to authentic sources, and they are authentic guidelines. But there are also certain practices that people perceive as coming from the tradition, but which are not really based on the tradition, in the sense that, yes, they occurred in the past in history, but they don't necessarily come from the spirit or the core of the tradition. Okay. For instance, I remember Gulen giving the example of the ladies in certain homes serving as if they are the servants of the elder of the house, like their parents-in-law. And Gulen said clearly that this is something from cultural tradition. It has nothing to do with religion. Women are not supposed to be in that position. So this should be clarified. He gave another example of the relationship between his mother and father, when his father in one case attempted to say something bad toward his mother. His grandmother intervened and said something very harsh to his father, stopping him from saying something negative to his mother. And he gives many other examples like that to distinguish what is truly in the tradition, and it is in the spirit of the tradition, versus what is in history. It is in the tradition technically, but it is not in the spirit of the tradition. Some of the practices that today we associate with observant Islam, when you look at Gulen's discourse and his recommendations, he traces some of these to actually cultural traditions and not necessarily in the spirit of the tradition. Now, in the particular case of can men and women do this and that, I'm not sure if I can speak to that particular incident. But the example that I gave as a woman being able to be a president or judge, I think it's a better, more important example. Some people may think that a woman cannot be a judge because, and in their mind, they might find a religious reason for that. So Gulen's point is that it may be historic, it may be in the tradition, historically speaking, but it is not in the spirit of the tradition. There is nothing preventing a woman from becoming a president or judge. I think that's more important than just handshaking or, things like that.
Okay, with that, I bring the formal part of the meeting to an end. But I if there are other questions that you might want to take up directly with Dr. Aslandogan, he may be around for a few more minutes. Just to underline the point that that I made to you on when you came last time, I really believe in an open discussion of issues, and this movement, perhaps more than any other of the overall Turkish picture, has been the subject of a great deal of discussion, criticism, suspicion, in spite of all the good work that is being done, that you underline. So the more there are events like this in which you and other members of the movement can explain the evolution, the better, I think it will be understood. With that, thank you all for coming, and thank you, Dr. Aslandogan, for coming as well.